Come on up here, Kate. Mark.
Kate, you go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
Greg, there's room on the other side there, too. Well, good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us this morning. Today I have David Asper, chair of the Manitoba Police Commission, with us. And obviously, we're making a report public today. Also happy to join us today, Mark Chipman from True North. And we have Greg Burnett, who is the Director of Safety Initiatives for the Downtown Safety Partnership. And Kate Fenske, who is the CEO of the Downtown Winnipeg Biz. I think you all know the challenges that we face in downtown Winnipeg and certainly across the province. And our report that was just commissioned clearly spells out that we have to work collaboratively to achieve the positive outcomes that we want for our Manitobans. And they are complex issues, certainly in terms of downtown. We as a government asked the Manitoba Police Commission to have a conversation with our stakeholders and bring forward best practices from other communities to see what we could do for downtown safety improvement. And today we're happy to make that report public. Certainly I want to thank David and the Police Commission for their work in this regard. And certainly this is one of the commitments we made, a 100-day commitment prior to our sort of post-election promise. There certainly is a lot of recommendations and advice in this report. I would view this information to assist as a roadmap in terms of the work that the Downtown Safety Partnership is doing. Certainly that work has started, and I know they have a lot of work ahead of them, and I'm hoping this document will help facilitate their discussions and their work as they go forward. Clearly, the report talks about private and public cooperation and partnerships, and I think this is going to be an effective way and a new way to do business. We also, as a government, certainly have released the policing and public safety. This document, I think, builds on that report and that strategy. And clearly, these reports and strategies signify that we all have to work together. Both all levels of government, the private sector, we have to bring our social services together, including our health sector as well, because we are dealing with complex issues. Certainly, I think our role as the provincial government, we're certainly here to facilitate the work that is going to be done by the Downtown Business Partnership. I think that's very important, so we look forward to further discussions with them as this these discussions evolve here in Winnipeg. So further to this, we are also want to make sure that we're engaging all Manitobans as we move forward when we talk about public safety. This is why we are asking the Manitoba Police Commission to establish and coordinate six community committees. So they will be discussing public safety in various other communities, including and outside of Winnipeg. And we're looking forward to the Police Commission undertaking that discussion with key stakeholders across the province and then reporting back to the province as well. That way we as a government certainly understand the local concerns, we can track results, and we can make informed decisions as we move forward. So with that, I thank everyone for coming this morning. We will field some questions, but I'm going to ask David for a few comments right now.
Thank you, Minister. What I propose to do is simply make a few acknowledgements and leave the substantive issues for any questions that you might have. We were asked on September 18th to conduct an initial consultation with a reporting date of November 18th, which effectively was the 15th, because that was a Sunday. And that's a very short period of time to try to look into a very complex problem. I think we had considerable success in getting a first look and providing the minister with an initial report. I want to acknowledge that it took a tremendous amount of work to get that done. To my colleagues on the commission, Vice Chair Jeanette Acheson and my colleagues on the commission, we received a great deal of information and had to digest it quite quickly, and we had some very, very good substantive discussions around the table and worked in a spirit of collaboration amongst ourselves. To our staff, Andrew and Lee, they actually carried most of the work here and did a tremendous job receiving, analyzing, researching, and synthesizing the information that gave rise to the report. To the stakeholders, we reached out to a lot of people. We covered a lot of ground. There's still more ground to cover. We're still getting some contact from people who are interested. But I want to thank all the stakeholders who did make time. And of course, Mark and Kate and Greg were a big part of that and helped inform our report. And finally, we did something a little bit unique, which was we opened the door to the public through our website, and we asked the public an open-ended question, which is, what advice would you provide? And we had a total of 174 responses, and there may be some resistance or reluctance to do that because of what you might get through the internet. And we received, I would say of the 174, there was 170 very thoughtful, good responses from concerned citizens in Winnipeg. And that informed, actually, some of our conclusions about the nature of community engagement. And it was an affirmation that part of this dialogue has to continue to involve ordinary citizens who have common sense solutions and sometimes cut through some of the larger issues or the distractions that we can get into. And so I think that we got enough basis to provide the minister with a starting point. A pilot project is underway now under the leadership of Mark and through the downtown biz, and Greg's going to be overseeing that. The final thing that we want to try to do, and what became clear, was that we have to try to create a different tone in this process. And the tone has to be less I'm right, you're wrong, and more about trying things and being willing to admit when things don't work and switch gears and try something else. Without identifying whether it was a good idea or a bad idea, there is no bad ideas. And that's part of the community engagement and the tone that we hope to facilitate going forward. And I know it's what's been informing the pilot with Mark and the downtown biz, and I hope that that can carry forward and we can get to some common sense, practical perspectives on dealing with downtown safety and safety generally throughout the province. Thank you.
Certainly, the city is a key stakeholder in terms of the downtown biz partnership, and certainly there has been a lot of consultation with the Winnipeg Police as well, and certainly that dialogue will continue. You know, just about a week and a half ago, the mayor and the premier sat down in discussions about this topic. So we have a very positive working relationship with the city when it comes to downtown safety. I would say the City of Winnipeg has been very involved in this process, and they will continue to be involved in this process. And certainly the Premier and the Mayor have been working collaboratively in terms of outcomes for this particular pilot. They want to see it succeed, so we're having very positive discussions. I would also say we're engaging the federal government in this process as well. In fact, I had a very positive discussion with the federal minister of public safety just yesterday. I think there's going to be a role for them to play here. Clearly, when it comes to some of the projects that go forward, we're optimistic, and a very positive discussion with Minister Blair. And he knows the concerns we have. He's spoken to the mayor, he's spoken to the premier about downtown safety in Winnipeg. So he's well aware of it. And I think this is all levels of government have to work together to achieve the outcomes that we want to achieve.
If I may, just on that point, I've been invited by the mayor to participate in the Bloomberg Harvard City Leadership Program, and I attended the first session of that a couple of weeks ago. And so I actually don't think, with all due respect, that symbolism matters really at this point, because there's a great deal of substantive work that's being done behind the scenes, and that work is continuing with that leadership group. And I can tell you that there was a tremendous spirit of cooperation and innovation in that meeting, involving both representatives of the province, the police commission was there, and members and representatives from various civic and community organizations. It's a great question. We heard that traffic actually is a problem with panhandling, when panhandlers are in the middle of traffic, and what to do about that. And so we simply raise as an issue, should the Highway Traffic Act be a tool in how we manage people walking in traffic and causing danger? And I should say, on the fine question, the commissioners debated that quite significantly, because the efficacy of fines when you're dealing with poverty is zero. However, under the Summary Conviction Act, that's the remedies that are available. So it may lead to broader consideration of various provincial statutes. Well, except the people of Winnipeg consistently rate road safety as one of their top priorities. And you've got an intersection of a road safety problem and a panhandling problem, and there may be some room within the Highway Traffic Act to try to deal with that. That's all we're saying. And there's technology which allows it to recognize certain behaviors. So assaultive behavior, for example, will draw the alert to video monitors. So the answer is yes.
And facial recognition
software? It could. Lots of discussion about that. Needs further consideration.
Sure.
Yes.
Okay. How would you toughen that up, given the fact that this is still part of the constitution?
The answer is, I don't know. We don't know. There's no good answer to it. And we heard many, many interesting voices on this. It's easy to say we've got to deal with panhandling. It's not so easy to say how. And so I think what we want to do is elevate it and continue the dialogue about what to do about it. And this leads often to root cause discussions about why people are out there begging. But I don't have an answer for you.
Well, I think it's very, very important. You know, I would stress that where we're at right now is in a pilot phase of exploration, of finding a better way to manage the issue of safety in our downtown, such that it might be expanded, leveraged to perhaps incorporate more of the city. And what I mean by that is, and I would say that our presence here today would suggest to you that I think we've come to understand that this is not necessarily a problem that lays at the feet of government in and of itself, or the police service, who do remarkable work every day on behalf of our community. We've explored some other communities that have very thoughtfully combined the resources and efforts of the private and public sector to effectively take on the issue of community wellness and safety. And I guess I would just add that I think it's very important to understand that you know, what we're talking about now and is not the panacea necessarily that some may be looking for to cure, you know, the challenges that we're focusing on. There is a much broader range of subjects that need to be tackled at the same time. You know, that is to say, the root causes of the issues that we're currently faced. And I'm getting a strong sense that both in the private sector and public, that there's a great deal of urgency around those subjects as well. Yeah, there's been no hesitation whatsoever, and more a willingness to, or an offer of how they can become involved and help. I think there's, you know, a general understanding that the well-being of our city is at stake right now, and I think that's one of the things that defines our community and Winnipeggers right across, you know, the entire spectrum, is that there's a deep sense of pride in our community, and when we come together as we have in so many different ways over many, many decades, we can create a better community. And so that's the sense I get from the people I talk to, is, you know, this is a challenge we're facing right now. There have been challenges in the past and there will be challenges in the future, but the extent to which we can organize ourselves collectively, collaboratively, you know, as David said, without you know, finger pointing or blame, but just coming together and finding new ways to solve issues. We have a history of being able to do that, and I'm quite confident we'll be successful again.
Yeah, there's a number of references in the report to potential legislative changes. From my perspective, we're going to allow the Downtown Safety Partnership to do its work. They will bring forward priorities to government, and we will certainly act on those priorities that they bring forward. Well, again, we're getting into the specifics of operations there, and again, from my perspective, we're going to allow the Downtown Safety Partnership to do its work. They will bring forward priorities. They will design models. Certainly, they will design their own governance model as they go forward. From our perspective as a provincial government, we're certainly here to facilitate their priorities.
So,
well, there's a lot of differences there for sure, and I don't know if you want to speak to that, but there's certainly is a more comprehensive approach, and that's what we've seen in with the Minneapolis model. But David, do you want to talk about details?
I think the starting point is with geography. The way we define downtown is to create a very large space, and so what Mark and Kate and Greg are looking at doing is taking a smaller slice of that, a smaller bite, and try some things to see if it'll work in a smaller piece of geography. And then, as Mark just said, to then learn things, make mistakes, have successes, and then try to expand that outward. How that's different from the Winnipeg Police Service is that the Winnipeg Police Service is trying to manage a call volume relating to crime, the commission of crimes largely. A lot of what creates the perception of being unsafe may not necessarily be crime related. And you can see in our recommendations, for example, under Intoxicated Persons Detention Act, that maybe shouldn't be a police activity anymore. We've talked about more civilian foot patrols. So I think that the idea here is to try something different under the model that's being proposed on a pilot, confined basis, see what works, and then see if it can be expanded outward. And that is different because the police have got a very expansive mandate here. and they're having difficulty managing their calls for service. We actually had conflicting information about the adequacy of lighting in downtown. And so our recommendations say, let's get the right answer. Because people, clearly, their perception of what's safe and not safe at night is that there may be too many dark spots. And so we need an answer that we can rely on, and then a solution. And there is a program currently to promote lighting on buildings in and around downtown. And it's having some degree of success, but not enough. Okay, so instead of, here's a great example, and saying, well, that's a big failure and we're gonna blame somebody and politicize it, we say, okay, well, we tried that. It got limited success. Now, you know, how do we tweak that to make it more effective?
What is the difference between the current system and the recommendation here to take away the incarceration option for chronic offenders and essentially force them into security?
Again, we had quite a robust discussion about this, obviously, because we are trying to balance liberty interests with the legitimate interests of society in punishment, deterrence, and rehabilitation. And obviously, there's a jurisdictional question between what's a federal area of jurisdiction and what's a provincial jurisdiction, and you can't be affecting the criminal code as a sentencing provision. So the question then became, well, what about if the chronic offenders are in sort of a loop that's driven by their social condition, their addictions, potentially their mental health condition? Is there a provincial responsibility, i.e. health, that might be able to intervene? And we did a little bit of research. We did find in some jurisdictions where secure treatment was helping people get out of the circumstances that were either leading to or causing their problems. And it was a wraparound service which involved not just detox and addiction counseling in those circumstances, but also work training and helping with job placement and skills training. And it's not going to work all the time, but it's having more success potentially. Well, that was the discussion point. We're not sure, but yes, that is the. I mean, at some point, a court is going to incarcerate somebody who's a chronic offender. They are going to incarcerate them, and there is no choice.
Well, we look forward to the downtown partnership doing their work. Clearly, they're going to be working with the city and Winnipeg Police Services. Obviously, there could be recommendations coming forward in terms of how we better use police resources. You will know we have set aside $10 million on public safety. We have not earmarked any money specifically to this particular project. We will let the partnership do its work. They will make recommendations back to us. We are certainly committed to working with all levels of government to provide better outcomes for Manitoba when it comes to public safety. You know, and as talked about, really this is about dealing with people. And in a lot of cases, our first response when we see somebody in need is to call the police. And a lot of our police resources are getting eaten up by maybe there's another way to deal with those people. And that's the approach that the Downtown Safety Partnership is looking at. How can we better provide services to these people that need services? Certainly from government, we realize there's a tremendous need for mental health and addiction services. We're investing in mental health and addiction services across the province. We have to make sure that these individuals that need these services get those particular services. So that's going to be a key initiative of this downtown partnership. We've committed that. We've committed $20 million for mental health and addictions already. We want to make sure that our police resources are getting used to their best value. That's one of the key eight strategies that we've laid out under our policing and public safety. We've had conversations. They knew that this was going to be on today, and we're in constant dialogue with the city and WPS. I appreciate that. There are a lot of organizations doing great work across our province. Our government has always been about outcomes, and we want to provide positive outcomes for Manitobans. And in saying that, yes, it's important to evaluate the services that organizations are providing. And I think you've heard that around the table. Is how do we coordinate all of the services, the entities that are providing those services, and making sure we're getting the services that Manitobans deserve. So that will be a really important part of this discussion as the Downtown Safety Partnership does its work.